rich, powerful, philanthropic, successful, these are some of the words that you will find on the only show that brings you closer to your icon. The Icon.
He's a business guru, as people may like to call him. So I would want to know the secrets behind that.
What motivates you? You know, what made him this successful?
That guy gives success a whole new meaning.
He's still so grounded. So I want to know, how has he remained so grounded? I'd want to take a photo with him. Yes.
Welcome to the first ever show that brings you closer to your icons.
My name is Paul Jugona Kiragori. I'm 26 years old. I'm a businessman. I run the entertainment industry.
I'm Angeline Wanjeri Mashira, and I'm 28 years old. I'm a scriptwriter, aspiring TV host, and TV actress.
My name is Mungai Kimani. I'm 27 years old. I am many things. Some of them are, I'm an advocate by training. I'm a student as well. I'm currently doing my MBA at the greatest university this side of the Sahara, Kemu. I am a staunch Manchester United fan. I love the Lord Jesus Christ so very much.
Basically for me, ambition, because I believe in it, I revel in it, I understand it, and I love people that are ambitious. And when I see ambitious, successful people, that really intrigues me completely, because I want to know how they did it, how they became the people they are. To me, it's all about ambition, yeah.
Me, I love simple things. I love a simple meal, a simple girl. Yeah, simple things. I love simple, yeah.
So right now, I have my freedom, and freedom in terms of money, in terms of time, and so that's what I wanted, as in I still got to make money, but I still got to sleep.
Today we shine a spotlight on someone you have come to know as one of the most philanthropic men in Africa. He opens up his heart and helps people across Africa to build their lives for the better. Well, he opened up his offices for us and gave us a glimpse of his life and lots of advice for the African youth. On 1st March 1929, an icon was born. His middle name, Excellence. He has been named by Forbes magazine as top 10 African millionaires to watch. Other than that, he has awards and accolades in his name. One of them is the Order of the British Council. You want to know who he is? Dr. Manu Chandaria. Dr. Manu Chandaria is one of the most recognizable names in Africa, and it gives us Kenyans such a sense of pride to know that this remarkable icon is one of our own. Along with being the chairman and CEO of the Comcraft Group of Companies, a billion-dollar enterprise that has a presence of over 40 countries, he is on the board of several prominent East African companies. He has won several awards in East Africa and internationally, and is also a noted philanthropist. In 2003, Dr. Chandaria was awarded the Order of the British Empire by Queen Elizabeth II. In December of the same year, he was awarded the Elder of the Burning Spear by former President Mwai Kibaki, one of the highest civilian honors in Kenya. Did I mention that he has also been named by Forbes magazine as one of the top 10 richest men to watch in Africa?
Thank you so much for having us today in your offices. It's a pleasure meeting you, and it's a pleasure being here with you. Well, the first question I'd really want to know is, how was it growing up for you, like from your teenage years to your youth? How was it for you?
Well, it's many years back that I was a baby and teenager. It so happened that I was born in Kenya, in Nairobi. And in the initial period of first 10 years of my life, I moved from Nairobi to Mombasa because my parents moved and I had to go with them. When they came back to Nairobi, I also came back. So it was only few last years of 4 years or 5 years of schooling that I had attended here. And then during the World War II, the whole family decided that all younger people, women, and older people must go to India because they don't want to take any chance of any warfare. Because we had a neighbor, which was Somalia, and it was Italian Somaliland. And Museveni had joined Hitler. So he had already also triggered a small little bomb in the northern area. So the Asian community, at least, was very much worried. So all the younger people, like us and many other families, have been sent out. And that gave us another totally new dimension of going from one country to another country. For the first time we saw trams. As soon as we landed in Mumbai, we saw trams. We had never seen it before. We saw double-decker buses. We saw high buildings, which we had never seen in this here. You know, all this, and wide boulevards, and some taxis, and some cars, and numbers were quite number. So it really first impressed that, yes, where we are in Nairobi, and where we are now in Mumbai. Obviously, that didn't last very long, because we were then taken to a smaller place in India. And that particular place, I went to my high school, and it was tough because competition and schools were very strong, but at the same time it was different. But during that period, what we also learned is the culture. We started learning, we started reading, which over here, because I was too young, maybe I didn't read very much, but when I went over there, I started reading. And more or less many read books that I read made a very strong impression on me. That also gave me a skill to write in my own language, because English was very little there anyway. And then while we were there, we got also a chance to go to the university. Now, our parents were hardly educated. My father was only 3 vernacular in primary school. My mother was illiterate. But he made very sure that all children of the family must get educated, because his biggest handicap was no education, no opening of mind, so he could not do anything very much. But he worked very hard and sent us all, and that gave us the time as to become the graduates in India. Not only that, but he said, now you go out. And at least 2 of us were sent out to the 4 cousins and brothers who were there. 2 of us were sent out to even America. So this was how it built up. And again, when he went to America, it was a totally new experience. It shook us that these are human beings. What we were in Nairobi, what we were in Mumbai. Now we went to London on the way to the United States. And when we landed in New York, it was totally, we just couldn't believe ourselves that human beings can do. They are all same type, 2 hands, 1 head, 2 eyes, 2 ears, and what have they achieved? I'm talking many years back, but it made such a strong impression on us that yes, things are doable. And that's why many a times we want you to go out from here. Even if you don't have very much of time, just go for 15 days. go to India, go to South Africa, go somewhere, hitchhike if necessary, but go and see the impact that will create in your mind. So that was one thing that happened.
So I graduated in 2008. When I graduated, I really didn't feel like I wanted to go to court. The whole tie and anything, I didn't want. So just before I joined the law school, I started a business for transport. So I got my first truck from a loan, Equity Bank, and I started supplying ballast and mchanga and mawe za kware. That was then. And then I started seeing I can also use this and still get to do a few other things on the side. My dad is my like role model. He helped me fund my first thing.
When we came back, obviously I did my master's in engineering. We came back and we were, by then, during the wartime, we had lost all of our assets. We were very poor people then. So what happened then is the choice. We had a 40 people working in a plant, making sufuriyas, Kalu Works in Mombasa. And four of us, plus my two elder brothers, plus my two uncles. And we're just wondering, 40 people and 6-7 people of the family on top of it, when you go home, there are 30 members of the family. Should we really take this challenge? Or just walk away? Because I had a master's degree, my brother, all of them graduated very well. And just take a cozy job, 9 to 5. But then it occurred to us that our parents has gone through so much of problems, so much of difficulty. From nothing, they built a little, I wouldn't say empire, just a little stage from where you can jump. Just a little place where you think you've got a capacity now to do something. So this was most important part, the lesson. And we thought, no, our parents had really worked very hard and we are going to continue supporting the family, work for the family, and will not see day and night. But we made very sure that we will add value of what we've learned and make our family better than what it is today. And in 5 years' time, we built and we had 500 people working. It was ingenuity, it was hard work, it was imagining things which you can never do. But at the end of the day, each started giving results. And the best way of getting encouraged is always this. More you perceive, more you start looking at it, more the world opens to you. And so it gave us an extremely interesting possibility. So from that little beginning, in 1951, we were then spread out, first in Eastern Africa, then in Europe, then whole of Africa, there are 16, and there are now 50 countries. So the first lesson, everything is doable, provided you have a mindset that nothing is achieved without hard work, focus, discipline, and be at it. There must be a desire, burning desire. Yes, I want to succeed. Yes, I want to do it. If you don't have that, then you will be one of those who are in the line. And when your turn comes, maybe it's already sunset. So this is what I would suggest, that what built me and my family and my friend and my members of other family, it's not that I built everything, but it was a cooperative effort of all put together. And each one of them were willing to put in more than they could normally do. And human being is always very selfish. If I can do without doing very many things and I can survive, I don't want to do it. It's a human nature. So you got to kick yourself first and say, no, I have a plan, I want to do it, I will do it. So unless these bases are there, success is not always there.
I believe as long as you have it, give. Yeah, give as much as you can, because you're getting in ample amounts. I mean, why not give back to people that really need it? There are people who want to be in the same shoes as we are, you know, successful and doing it, but they can't due to lack of no education or other things that they're missing in life. So if I'm making it, if I have the money, why not share it with these unfortunate people? Chandara is a well-known household name, and it was founded by an M.M. Chandara. So in understanding a bit of the history, we'd just like to know what do the initials M.M.
No. It was not M.M. Chandaria.
Oh, it was?
M.M. Chandaria, there are many Chandarias in this town. It was my brother, we were all called Shahs first, S-H-A-H, and we were known as Biasara people and Biasara Street. But then he decided that he would like to change his name instead of calling everybody Shah, Shah P and Shah K and Shah D and Shah this. He decided that why don't you pick up the name or the family name, which was in India. So he picked it up. And it was one line of one name in the telephone book. Then once the growth of Chandaria started taking place, all the guys who were sitting with the name Shahs and were Chandarias started calling them Chandarias. So today you'll see more than 3/4 page or maybe a whole page of Chandarias in there. Now M.M. Chandaria is one person who built Chandaria Industries. He used to work for us, it's one of our firms. And then he decided to start his own business while working, as I'm suggesting to you. While he was working with us, he started doing some little businesses on the side of manufacturing straws. And so that's how it started. Then after straws, he became a little successful. He started making toilet rolls. And so from that day onwards, he kept on it. Now he's got a bank. He's got a recycling plant of paper. He's got paper mills. He makes all kinds of paper, right from toilet rolls right up to the tissue papers. We never gave a name Chandaria to any of our companies. Neither we gave a name as a corporate organization to any companies. Maybe we have more than 200-300 companies, probably 300 plus. We don't have the same name to anything. So we only said, it's my brother who was D.P. Chandaria. It was my second brother who was R.P. Chandaria. It was my other brother who was Keshav Chandaria, myself, and my two cousins. And then other cousins joined, other nephews joined. And today we are 16 working members in the family. 65 members, or 50 members total, men, women, and children. And they're all distributed in London, Geneva, Nairobi, Singapore, and Toronto. So Chandaria, the name M.M. Chandaria is not M.M. Chandaria. The joke is always there that the cards goes to him, Manu Chandaria, Chandaria Industries. If the card is to support somebody, he'll send it to me. If card is an invitation, he'll accept. No, this is a good friend of ours, and all, it's a very close family members.
I would want to know what the main reason for him having gone to India and the United States. Back then, the economy was up there. As in considering whatever Kenyan was going through, we were just being born. So for me, I would have opted to stay in the US and start a business there. But the main reason behind him coming back to Kenya, he must have loved this country so much. So one thing I would want to ask him is, like, what's the reason behind, as in, what's the secret behind loving Kenya? Because no one would do something so blindly and just come back home and start from down there and to what he is. He knew something.
You spent UK, in the US, and in India during your studies as a youth. And that time in Kenya, the economy in Kenya was very low. It hasn't even started growing. For many youth would have opted to stay in America, where they had all those technologies, and use their talent there. Why did you opt to come back home and start from zero?
Well, the point is that when you go to any other country, first, we came from a united family, joint family, where if mother is not there, aunt is there. If the aunt is not there, elder brother's wife is there. You know, they're a very, very close family. And we went from India, and our philosophy was very different than what people would go from here into Canada, into United States, into London. But to them, they have no basis. But we had a little base, that there was a big family, that they're working hard, that from nothing they've built something today. They allowed us to go all this. So I think the idea never occurred that we will stay there. Because we had something here back. So the love and affection was always binding.
I'd love to know, who is your role model? Who inspired you into venturing in business?
Well, business, you know, when we came into this country, we were not business people. Our families were farmers. Just like what you got here, majority of you people, your background is coming from home, is farms. We came over here because people told us that, to our parents, that this is a very green country. You just throw things like that, it'll grow. And it was virgin country. So they thought that, well, will we have a better chance to come over here? By the time when they started lending, and they're finding that no land was available, it was all given to Mzungus. There was no land for Africans except lands where you cannot do anything, or savannas, where it's very difficult to grow. So in Kenya, it was only 18% land, which is good land. The rest is all semi-arid land, and then bad land, or savannas and desert. So the land was just, there was no piece of land. So then they followed, what else? To work for somebody. And the somebody wanted to increase his business. So the minute my parents came up and said, now I would like to set up my own business, I said, go ahead, please, because you are another customer. So go out of this particular area, go a few kilometers away. And that's how you saw all the Asian community from every corner of Kenya, they were distributed, because there was no saying no to anybody. If I was a shopkeeper and I had employed you and you wanted to start something, come on, get going. I'll support you. Go to Kirinagia, go to Meru, go to here. And that is up to you now. And that's how the business was built. It's not a control, but we are in the industries now, more in industry than in trade. So it's a reincarnation in 100 years. A thousandth year of history of farmers turning into business people, turning into industrialists. And now some of our children are turning professionals. They're accountants and they're lawyers and they're again changing faces, that they're not going to be industrialists. If I tell my children to come back and work in Kenya, he said, no, that's gone days. Lives in Singapore, another lives in Geneva, another lives in London. To them, it's okay, come and see a game here, but that's it. The point is that it's evolution. that takes place. But that evolution must bring you something, add value. And that's how it has happened.
Currently, I started something called Conscious Fashion, the future of fashion. I got it. I'm doing women's stuff now. I have handbags and clutches and watches and heels. I didn't. If you want to shop, you shop from me. Like, I met a woman who's becoming a star. She was very beautiful, leaving people in awe, singing songs, Lena Horne, but the younger version. So what I decided is to start with, I can start by selling from my car book. Drugs all in the nose, could have died so young, now looks ugly and old. No fun, cause now when she reaches for hugs, people hold their breath, cause she smells of corrosion and death.
As much as I'm doing from the car book, some sort of professionalism helps. Even your client, you're like, you have a receipt, you have branded paper bag. You see, those small, tiny things, once in a while we have freebies. So you buy something from me and I'll give you that thing for putting on your hair, or I'll give you a brass strap. May sound small, but are those small things? Yes.
So I go around, guys call me the modern hooker, because I'll show up at your offices and I try and seal a deal.
Entrepreneurship has become the new front in Africa and in Kenya. And as one of the leading entrepreneurs in Kenya and Africa, and I believe the world, what advice would you have for us as young entrepreneurs who are getting into this game?
Well, I think that in life, unless first you decide that you want to stand and not fall, that's the first decision you make. Many times I keep looking, is this a science? No. Is this an art? No. What is entrepreneurship? Entrepreneurship is the hunger that you have in you to be something, to become something, to create something. That's the hunger which I call entrepreneurship. A fire in the belly. That is what entrepreneurship is all about. We can only teach you ways and means of writing your books and doing this and doing that, but that does not teach you what we call shocks that comes into your life. I went to Mumbai, it was a shock. I went to London, it was a shock. I went to New York, it was another shock. That gave me a capacity. That, hey man, these are also people. And so the fundamentals of entrepreneurship is your own determination and wanting to become somebody. It might fail, but having no dreams, having no ideas, no thoughts, you'll never become one. If I had to remain over here, yes, I would be probably in Biashara Street. My father would have taken one more shop and I would be managing the shop. That's what I would be. But it allowed me to change. And I made decision that this experience of change, I want to make it happen. So that's entrepreneurship to me. I'll send you my speeches on entrepreneurship. But the point is, what is it is awakening your capacity, your desire. That's awakening. That in a school you will not be able to do. And that's why I'm trying now many business schools to get people to come and talk as compulsory as you people go and work with others outside rather than only just be in school and enjoy and do the lessons and see your professors. They are not the makers. They show you a way. Makers are the guys who have made it. And those you follow.